2002, January 8th, and this is how many of us felt when we saw that No Child Left Behind had been signed into law. There was that sort of shocking moment because many people in the practice and research communities were aware from the very beginning that this law would have a tortured existence until it finally was changed. And then on December 11th, 2015, No Child Left Behind was left behind. Now, I'm a former English teacher, so I like English teacher cartoons. This one says, "Today you're going to learn the meaning of irony." And so why was NCLB so ironic? Well, it was passed on the heels of 9/11 as a Democrats and Republicans getting something done to move the nation forward. Input from the education or the research communities. The law had noble goals to indeed leave no child left behind, to enact greater equity, and had important insights about the transparency of data for attention to equity and the disaggregation of data for different groups of students, the aspiration to see progress made at closing of the gap was appropriate and noble. But it sought to achieve those goals with extremely problematic strategies for school change. And we have seen the march over the last subsequent years to the point where, as we try to get 100% of schools to reach proficiency for every subgroup, that virtually every school in the country was declared, every public school was declared in need of improvement or failing because the targets could not be met. The NCLB theory of action was if we focus on school achievement tied to incentives and sanctions, educators and policymakers will improve education. The strategies were to require annual testing, to set targets to reach 100% proficiency overall and for subgroups. Embedded in those, some of you will know, was the English learner catch 22, because that group was supposed to get to 100% proficient, but whenever kids became proficient, they were taken out of the group. And I don't know how many of us had how many conversations with people in Washington about the fact that that, you know, was not going to ever be accomplishable. And states like California and others that have a lot of English learners found those schools immediately declared in need of improvement because the faster they made kids proficient, the faster they were declared failing by the rules of the law. A strategy to identify schools that fail to meet all targets. If you were in a diverse school, you might have 30 plus targets that you needed to meet for all of the subgroups in a given year. If you met, you know, all but one, you were still declared in need of improvement or failing, depending on how far down the track you were. Then, of course, implementing school consequences, which were predetermined by the federal government in terms of what those consequences could be. You could reconstitute the school, fire the principal, hire new teachers, turn it into a charter, implement certain kinds of strategies for improvement, and so on. And then under waivers, the next part of the strategy was to tie student test scores to teacher evaluation. So that's really been the framework for school improvement. And what essentially happened during that era was that test-based accountability became the idea of school improvement in the country. It really created the entire parameter. Very early on, members of AERA understood that this would be problematic. In his presidential address in 2003, just a year after the law was passed, and really the same year that it was beginning to be implemented, Bob Lynn did his talk on accountability, responsibility, and reasonable expectations. And before I tell you what he said, I just want to take a moment and think about Bob. He passed away this year. He was an amazing member of our community. So let's just take a moment for of silence for him. As in all things, Bob was very perspicacious. I think that's the word. Smart guy. Knew what he was talking about. He looked at that point at the trends on the National Assessment of Educational Progress, which was supposed to be the benchmark for deciding on proficiency. And he said, here's where we've been in reading in recent years. You can see the observed trends for grades 4, 8, and 12. And then he said, what would we need to do to reach 100% proficiency by 2014? And those are the steep slope lines going straight up after that point in time. He did a similar exercise in mathematics. And then he calculated what the projections to reach 100% proficiency would take if we continued to improve at that rate. 57 years for grade 4 mathematics, 61 for grade 8, 166 years for grade 12 mathematics, and then he calculated out. And of course, his point was that we really need to rethink accountability, that true accountability requires broadly shared responsibility, not just at the level of the school, but the level of the district and the state. System designs need to be informed by research and experience, not just drawn out of thin air. Performance expectations need to be ambitious but realistically attainable. And need some kind of existence proof test to legislate nationally that something should occur that had never happened before and no one had ever tested to see if it could happen seems a little bit irresponsible. But he also made the point that researchers need to share responsibility, that we need to be producing dependable information about strengths and weaknesses of interventions and educational strategies. And we need to do that not just for the single studies that we individually do, but we need to know our field and all the work that's come before. That's what makes us a profession, is that we build on each other's work so that we can speak to the policy and the practice community about the weight of the evidence and when something is likely to work under what circumstances, implemented in what way. We also need to produce dependable information about features of accountability systems that enhance the likelihood of positive influence on education while minimizing unintended negative side effects. Well, we have been busy this last decade or so producing a lot of research about the unintended negative side effects of No Child Left Behind, which grew a lot of different acronyms and slogans over the course of that time. I've heard it called No Child Left Untested, No Child Behind Left, many other things. And when I was working with President Obama in 2008 as part of the campaign, but I also was talking to people in Senator Clinton and Senator Biden's offices and with them about their education ideas, they were all stunned when they left Washington, went out into the country, and heard people talking about what the effects of federal policy were on their schools. It was interesting to me to realize what a bubble Washington, D.C. is, because the conversations many people were having, you were probably part of some of them, were not reaching the folks who had enacted the policy and were just coming out into the hinterlands at that time. Thank you so much. This is a psychic person. I appreciate you. If you sold those, you could make some money right now. You know, they say monetize it, right? So we did have a lot of research, and I can't even begin to talk about all of it. There was research about how the curriculum and teaching were being narrowed, both in terms of fewer content areas being taught in schools, particularly those serving low-income students, students of color, English learners, where the threat of sanctions was severe. The curriculum lost science, lost social studies, quite often art and PE and other things. It also became more focused on the methodologies of multiple choice testing. So kids were drilling on how to find one answer out of five, rather than how to communicate orally and in writing, how to inquire, how to investigate, how to prepare for the world outside of school. Incentives to push out and keep out low performers also came to light, and I want to acknowledge the Harvard-UCLA Civil Rights Project had a whole series of research that began to raise these concerns and issues about how a law intended to work on behalf of the highest need students was in fact restricting the learning opportunities of those very students. The National Research Council did a number of reports, one of them on the effects of high-stakes test-based accountability and the fact that it has not moved the needle
forward on learning. The Rand Corporation raised questions early on about the true learning effects that could be parsed out from test scores, the Center on Education Policy, and many, many others. So there was a cottage industry. One of the things that was found, and this was by Julian Vasquez-Heilig, one of my students at the time, but now a major figure in the field of public scholarship, was that the Texas Miracle, which had started No Child Left Behind, if you're old enough, you'll remember the conversations about the Texas Miracle, it looked like on the TOS tests that there were these huge gains in achievement. And people saw this graph. This was circulated widely in Washington, and graphs like it to say, well, wouldn't we want to do this nationwide? And of course, George Bush had been the governor of Texas. He was the president at the time. So Julian did a study in what came to be called Brazos City. And one of the things he discovered, getting all of the data for all of the kids over about a 15-year period and tracking their progress through school, was that first of all, the Stanford 9 tests, which were low-stakes tests, showed little gain. In fact, it's reasonably a little tiny gain and then drop again. And little closing of the gap between students of different groups, at odds with the TOS data. So what was going on there? The other thing that he found was that many of the high schools, well, the high schools as a whole, were losing a lot of students. So these are four cohorts of kids who entered ninth grade at the top of each of those lines, and the number who departed 4 years later was about 30% of those who entered. And investigating qualitatively as well as quantitatively what was going on there, what he found is that large numbers of students, sometimes as many as 25% in the elementary schools, were being held out of testing by being labeled English learners or students with disabilities, or being redshirted on testing day and just told to stay home. They had figured out that if they retained students in ninth grade, they wouldn't take the 10th grade accountability test. A lot of the ninth graders never did graduate and just got stuck in the ninth grade, but some managed to get enough credits to be skipped over to 11th grade, but they still never took the 10th grade test. And then there were large rates of disappearances, which kids just vanished from the database without a code. So it began to look like, in fact, part of the story of test-based accountability was figuring out how to get the scores, average scores boost, rather than necessarily being able to educate all the kids well. There were a lot of other research findings that had come out on the outcomes of high-stakes testing without investing, because recall that resources were not on the table here. The theory was that the testing alone would do the trick, and you're all familiar with the large gaps in funding that we have across states and within states to different districts, where there is usually a 3-to-1 ratio between high and low spending districts and inequalities within districts to different schools. So among those were findings that we were experiencing more rote-oriented curriculum. There were higher rates in many states of grade retention. Studies in Georgia, Massachusetts, South Carolina, New York, Florida, Texas found increasing dropout and push-out rates. Studies in Florida, Georgia, and Texas were documenting the loss of good teachers from low-ranked schools because of the punitive effects of the system, and then, of course, continued inequality in resources because the theory of change didn't include paying for more teachers or different programs or supports for kids in so-called failing schools. Lori Shepherd's presidential address in 2000 featured a slide somewhat like this one, in which she warned about the effects of low-quality, high-stakes testing. And in fact, we saw some of those outcomes. So what happened as a result? Well, the best-case scenario of outcomes from No Child Left Behind was fourth-grade math scores. There was very little movement at 8th or 12th grade, almost no movement in reading. But fourth grade math, we did see some improvements. But the rate of gain pre-NCLB was much steeper than the rate of gain post-NCLB. So So whatever we were doing in the 1990s was moving the dial faster than what happened in the 2000s. And this is on the National Assessment of Educational Progress. Now, you would think that with all the testing, because we've tripled the amount of testing, we would be among the best test takers in the world. But on PISA, the international assessments, we actually saw a decline in math, science, and reading between 2000 and 2012. So there are lots of reasons for this, including the increase in poverty and homelessness and a variety of other issues. But we weren't addressing those. We were just focused on sanctions for testing, and that obviously was not moving the bar. The other thing about PISA is that it's a very different kind of assessment from most of what we use in the United States, because it, two-thirds of it is open-ended questions. It asks students to apply their knowledge to solving a different problem, working with the material that's offered to them, which is very different from just finding one answer out of five. And our kids usually do the least well on the problem-solving elements. So, why haven't outcomes improved more? Well, for one thing, our state test focused on low-level skills. And we actually went backwards in the quality of testing, because in the 1990s, a variety of states, about 15 of them, had built assessment systems that looked very much like those in many other countries, like the UK, Australia, Singapore, Hong Kong, and so on, where kids are doing open-ended essays, problem solutions, and even projects that are part of the assessment system, scientific investigations, social science inquiry. Almost all the testing became multiple choice. States stopped making their own tests and bought tests off the shelf. The Department of Education did not want to approve any of the performance-based assessments that were being used in states. You may recall that Vermont and Kentucky had portfolios, and Maryland had performance tasks. Connecticut had performance tests and even sued the department to be able to keep them up, and they were told to just shift to multiple choice tests. There were no incentives for enriching the curriculum because we weren't looking at or caring about science, social studies, or other aspects of the curriculum. And you know, one of the places where I think we really missed the boat on this, I agree with Edie Hirsch on this, that when you're learning to read, you have to read in content and learn about things that you will then bring to your reading to be able to progress in reading. So just drilling on little passages and then bubbling in one answer out of five about a fact in a passage doesn't actually allow you to move to the higher levels of comprehension and use of reading material that we need in middle and high school, which is why we saw that our gains were almost exclusively in the elementary schools and not at the middle and the high school level. The drivers of achievement were invisible because we were only reporting and making, keeping tabs on test scores. And so other things that might make a difference were not being looked at or on the table. Mandated solutions were often unhelpful. In California, quite often the mandated solution was to eliminate all the content areas for low-scoring kids, give them 2 hours of literacy and 2 hours of math a day with nothing else around it. And it was unengaging, uninteresting, failing to trigger higher-order thinking skills or critical problem solving, and so that was not unusual across the country. And the focus on schools and teachers left important factors out of the mix. Growing poverty and homelessness, we doubled the number of homeless children in the last decade. We have more children in poverty, almost one out of four, than we had in the 1970s, and way more than any other country in the industrialized world. Inequality in school resources was not to be discussed. All of those were excuses. State and district policies were also off the table. Schools, little schools, were supposed to fix themselves, even if they'd been deprived of qualified teachers and adequate resources and the programs that they needed by that very state or district in which they sat. Standardized testing increased dramatically by 300%. As it was required in more grade levels, and that's one of the reasons states couldn't afford to keep up the more performance-oriented assessments. As of a survey a year or so ago, teachers were reporting that 85% said it, the testing they experienced undermines good teaching, and 45% said it makes them consider leaving the profession, and some certainly have done so. As one Texas teacher put it, I've seen more students who can pass the test but cannot apply those skills to anything if it's not in the test format. As for higher quality teaching, I'm not sure I would call it that, and many teachers have talked about what they were not able to do in order to focus on this. And of course, we've seen recently that students and parents are beginning to opt out. New York, of course, has been one of the places where that's substantially the case. There's a national opt-out movement. And the question is now before us. Can we develop a more effective approach to accountability? And I would argue that accountability is not a side issue. It has become the issue for how we think about the improvement of schools. So that question was coming up and coming up and coming up over the last few years. And with the support of the Hewlett Foundation, a group of folks met together to sort of ask that question, can we develop a more productive approach to accountability? And what you see in the list of people who contributed to a report that I'm going to talk about is that there were researchers highlighted in yellow. There were educators from school, district, state levels who were in various practice and policy positions. And then in blue and then in purple, others who were policy analysts, advisors, actors, of some prominence in various administrations. And this group got together and brainstormed about what would a new accountability system for college and career readiness really look like? Could we get a new paradigm? Began to talk about a set of new principles. They began with the idea that accountability does not equal testing, that really accountability should be about, if you have an accountable system, it would encourage high-quality teaching and learning in all schools. It would provide tools for continuous improvement, and it would provide means for identifying and addressing problems that require correction. Tests can offer information for an accountability system, but they do not by themselves create accountability. And think about it as a parent. You know, what parent goes up to a school and says, here's what I want you to do for my child. Can you please give them a lot of tests and give me numbers that describe them? I have not met that parent. So we thought about what would parents want from an accountability system. Well, the first thing you want is meaningful learning. You want kids to be focusing on the kind of learning that is empowering and engaging and prepares them for the life that they're going to encounter in the world outside of school. And that life is, as you all know, changing very rapidly. As a Stanford professor, I don't usually like to quote people from Cal Berkeley. And I bet there's somebody here in the room from Cal. There almost always is. Where are you guys? But there are these two professors at Cal who've been doing these studies of the growth of knowledge in the world. And they discovered that between 1999 and 2003, there was more new knowledge created in the world than in the entire history of the world preceding. Think about it. And now knowledge growth is on an exponential curve. Technology knowledge is doubling every 11 months. And by the time I finish this talk, it'll probably be every 10 months. It's the rate. And so our kids are going into a world where they will work with knowledge that hasn't been discovered yet, using technologies that have not been invented yet to solve problems that we have not managed to solve. So just dividing up the curriculum into the 12 years of school and saying, we're going to hand it out to you in dollops, and if you just memorize this and spit it back, you'll be baked and done, does not constitute meaningful learning for the world that they are entering. So we need to think about what would that meaningful learning be, and then how do we organize curriculum instruction assessment around it. Parents will tell you, we want solid professionals in the schools. We want the people who teach our kids and work with our kids to know what they're doing, to know how kids learn, and to be able to meet the needs of our individual brilliant students, because each of us has the most brilliant student that was ever that ever crossed the threshold into that school. And that's a form of professional accountability, a professional capacity. And then parents will say, we want the resources there, the materials and whatever else it takes for the kids to do that work for that meaningful learning to occur. So if you start from there and you say that's the foundation of an accountability system, then what does that mean for how our whole approach would change? Well, those ideas began to be discussed. The group actually posited a 51st state. And so what would a 51st state do? Since then, a group of states have come together as the 51st State Accountability Group to try to enact some of that work. A variety of other groups began to take this question up. What could be the new principles for accountability? A group of civil rights groups issued a statement and a letter to the President and the Congress about principles for a new accountability. Educator groups, AFT, NEA, administrators, PTA, Parents United and others, also did the same thing. Some of us helped organize meetings so that that conversation could go on. Many of them here in Washington, but some of them all around the country. And people came to some agreement. Mostly they said we should have accountability that's organized around system improvement, that it should be reciprocal. Every system level should have responsibility for the things it needs to do to make children learn. It should focus on this kind of meaningful learning with more valid forms of assessment, continuing to report them in disaggregated form. We should have accurate resources that are allocated intelligently, develop professional capacity as well as accountability, use multiple measures to figure out what students are learning and what schools are doing, focus on shifting from test and punish to assess, support, and improve, and reflect student, parent, educator, community input and involvement in that process. And some states have been moving ahead to design and develop systems like this. California was one of the earliest ones because we had a governor who said, I can do what California needs or I can do what Washington's telling me to do, I'm going to do what California needs. It just kind of started marching in a different direction. So we have a new theory of action. The new theory of action might be described as if we focus on what matters for learning, and require attention to continuous improvement, education will improve. The strategies involve improving the quality of curriculum and assessment, investing in educator and school capacity, encouraging a dashboard approach with multiple indicators reflecting not only student success, but also their engagement in school and their opportunities to learn. Put equity and resources back on the table. What do kids get the opportunity to learn? Because if you don't know what they have the opportunity to learn, how can you figure out if they're not learning what caused it? And then develop systems for school review. So we now have the Every Student Succeeds Act. Is it more of the same or is it a new start? And the first thing to know about that is that the accountability systems will largely be designed by the states. So it's up to you and your colleagues in your state what accountability and school improvement will mean. The secretary, this is unusual. There are about 15 things the secretary in the law is not allowed to regulate or prescribe. Among them is teacher evaluation, also the design of the accountability system. Multiple measures are required. There are 5 measures that must be used, English, language, arts, math, science, assessment scores, ELA and math in the same grade levels that we've seen before, and science once every grade span, English language proficiency gains, graduation rates must be included, and then at least one indicator that is about school climate or student success or opportunity learning. But states can do much more than that one, and some are looking at a dozen indicators to give a more complete picture of what's going on in their school. The nature of tests and their uses can change. In fact, the law says the assessments must measure higher order skills and may include performance tests and portfolios. There are more incentives in the law for well-designed professional learning for teachers and leaders. Some of the research that was being done and communicated found its way in about what constitutes high-quality professional learning and development. More incentives for community schools. which we haven't seen since the 1990s in the old version of the law, which can provide wraparound services and a lot of the other things that students need to be ready to learn. School integration is back on the agenda. We haven't seen that since the 1970s. It was eliminated in the 1980s from all of the federal investment. High school redesign is on the agenda. Resource equity is actually in the law. There's required reporting of dollars, expenditures, resources for schools. There are incentives for districts to adopt weighted student formulas. There are resource audits and investments that must be conducted when schools are identified as needing assistance. This is a huge change in the framework of the law. There's a lot of work to be done, and this is where you come in. We have to figure out all across the country how to define, design, and implement new accountability and improvement systems. We need to think about the nature of assessments and build assessments that reflect the skills, use them in ways that are for information and improvement rather than for sanctions and punishments. The nature and role of educator development is on the table, and the design of schools that can support stronger learning. What can inform this work? Well, there's a lot that we can learn from our own work in the States, but also from abroad. And I put up here the Singapore Education Examinations and Assessment Board and the Alberta Report Results Report, which is a multiple measure system they've been using in Alberta, Canada for a long time. Singapore is a place that, in order to move to a thinking schools, learning nation framework, has been doing project-based examinations and assessments for a number of years and bringing their curriculum into the 21st century. We may want to go back to the future because in the 1990s, a lot of this was happening in the United States, and understanding what worked then and what we learned from that is going to be important. During that time, Connecticut, Massachusetts, Kentucky, and North Carolina were all studied as states that had very large gains in achievement because of very systemic approaches to reform. Kentucky and North Carolina both were southern states that could have broken the glass ceiling of getting above the national average. Connecticut became number one in achievement in 1996. Massachusetts surpassed them by 1998. All of them had similar things going on. They raised and equalized teacher salaries, and in some cases did that by equalizing school funding or had that school funding equalization as a result. They all launched preschool and children's health initiatives. They raised standards for teaching and teacher education. They offered service scholarships to attract and prepare teachers of color and teachers in high-need fields and teachers who go to high-need locations. Mentoring, high-quality professional development. They revised assessments, and they pursued steady policies for more than 15 years. Many of these began to falter in the last decade, but some have held on to a lot of the practices that they developed. More recently, the New Jersey story, which I love because I started student teaching in Camden, New Jersey, where there were no books in the book room, there were no resources, there were court cases for 30 years where the state refused to put the same amount of money in the high minority, low income school districts of Newark, Camden, Patterson, Trenton, et cetera, as they put in Princeton and New Brunswick. And after 9 court cases telling them to equalize the funding, finally in 1998, Christy Todd Whitman did bring parity funding to those districts, but they also did many of the same things those other states had done: high quality preschool, teacher education and professional development, focused literacy and math programs. Whole school reform, and the most successful were those that organized around the Comer models, Jim's Comer's school development model, which supports child development and learning of child development by all the members of the community. And they then took fire, became one of the highest achieving states in the nation. They're now always in the top 5, closed the achievement gap in half because they pursued this set of reforms together. And in fact, of all the top achieving states, which include Connecticut, Massachusetts, New Jersey, typically also Vermont and often New Hampshire, New Jersey is the one that has the largest proportion of students of color, 45%, and about a third of the kids live in poverty, and there's still performing well because they're making investments in smart grids. Today, there's an innovation lab network that is working with a variety of states under the auspices of the Council of Chief State School Officers to try to move the needle on 21st century learning and new approaches to accountability and assessment. And a group of scholars and centers works with them and with the chiefs from University of Kentucky, University of Oregon, Stanford, and so on, the Center for Collaborative Education in New England, hand in glove, thinking about what do we know, how might that help you, envision what you might do, how do we test it and pilot it. We've piloted new assessments, refined them, new accountability systems are being developed. How can you share that knowledge with each other across policymakers in the states? How can practitioners be part of the conversation so that their districts at the table saying, this is what would help us? And then how can scholars help document, capture, contribute, and learn from and spread those lessons? And I think when we work in public scholarship, we want to change the way that policy unfolds, we have to work across these role groups. We have to work with one another to figure out how to move forward. So California, as I said, moved to a multiple measure system a little while ago as part of its school finance reforms, which now allocate funding based on student needs, poverty status, English learner status, foster care status, and ask every district to figure out how to allocate those new funds with their community involved, with teachers and educators involved, around these eight state priorities, which then constitute a way to look at school progress. Communities say, here's what we're gonna work on, what we think we need to do, here are the measures we're gonna use to evaluate our progress, and then we're gonna keep iterating each year as we see what's working, what's not working, and so on. The core districts in California are the largest districts, Los Angeles, San Francisco, Long Beach, Fresno, et cetera. They've developed an approach to accountability which has an academic domain, a set of academic indicators, a social-emotional domain. They're looking at social-emotional learning and climate and culture in the schools, as well as suspension and expulsion rates. You know that one of the biggest barriers in many schools is the high rate of suspension and expulsion that is disproportionate for students of color. So measuring that, as the state is doing and as these districts are, and holding themselves accountable for finding new approaches to social-emotional skill development, to restorative justice, is bringing those exclusionary tactics down. Measuring chronic absenteeism and holding oneself accountable for figuring out how to meet the needs of kids who are being kept out of school. And then, of course, culture and climate. So there's a way by which you can begin to think about the whole child, the whole school, all of the elements that may make a difference, and redesign the way we think about what we're paying attention to and what our continuous improvement strategies are about. In the core districts, if schools are found to be struggling on a number of these indicators, they undertake a school quality review in which experts, kind of like the inspectorates that you know of from some other countries, but a little more democratic. So there's peers who come in along with some experts who look at the data, they look at the teaching, they look at the learning, they look at student work, they look at classroom practice, and then they help develop a diagnostic for what could be done. Developing a continuously improving system, figuring out how to provide learning supports and information, ongoing review, innovation, and knowledge sharing is on the table. How do we do that? It should not be the case. Anywhere in this country, with all the knowledge we produce, we have the most active, well-used research body and community in this country, of any country in the world. Everybody comes here and studies our innovations and uses our research. But do we use it? Not so much. Because of this divide between policy, research, and practice, we've got to figure out how to build these systems. So it should not be the case that if I'm in a district, stay in California, which is my current home, where we are struggling to make progress with English language learners, don't know what to do, don't know what has succeeded elsewhere. I should not have to go running around looking under rocks to figure out where that knowledge is. And the truth is, I'm sorry to say it, I'm not going to read the AERA journals to find it. It's not likely. Somebody's got to synthesize that knowledge. Departments of education might do this. Researchers might partner in this to say, here's what we know from across multiple studies. Here are strategies that might be productive in different contexts. Here's the kind of implementation that we know is important. Here are places, districts and schools that are succeeding. You can go look at them. You can go visit. You can talk. We can document what they're doing. We can help make that knowledge shareable. So if we want to have a system in which knowledge and action are in sync, we've got to figure out how to make the knowledge available to those who need it where they need it, in the way that they can use it, so that they can move forward. We need to figure out what kind of assessment is going to be prevalent in this new system. Are we going to continue to look like that, or the analog with computers? Or will we get to the place where we're really engaged in the kind of performance assessments that our kids would experience if they were in Queensland, Australia, or Victoria, or Singapore, or the UK, where they're actually engaged in investigations, writing them up, and being evaluated? That Innovation Lab Network has created a performance assessment resource bank, which is full of performance tasks that illustrate this. They're trying to move along the continuum from where we've been, measuring low-level skills. RAND found, by the way, that in the states with the highest standards, 98% of the math items were low-level. Only 2% measured higher order thinking skills. 80% of the English language arts measures were low-level. Only 20% measured higher order thinking skills. So we're counting ourselves out of the global knowledge game if we don't move along this continuum to where some other countries and some schools in the United States are, where they engage in performance-based tasks, extended tasks like those that the Innovation Lab Network is pulling together, even student design projects. In Singapore, your science examination will be a practical assessment where you essentially identify a problem and do an experiment, record it, and write up a little science journal article. In the Innovation Lab Network, things like these math performance tasks begin to be what teachers can work around. They've been piloted in the States. This one has kids figure out the rising cost of colleges in an in-state community college, out-of-state college, and an Ivy League college, and then write an article, equations that map the slope of the increases in an article about the rising cost of college. The states are also working on professional capacity building. You can see in places like Iowa, where they've got a major initiative around teacher leadership, in Kentucky, where they're rebuilding subject matter networks. California has an innovative instructional leadership core, where teachers are learning to provide professional development to their colleagues in their districts to build capacity around the new standards. Teachers involved in design and scoring of performance assessments, which we know builds their capacity and knowledge of the standards and so on, and school quality reviews in Vermont. So there are lots of places to go study where elements are being put in place. There are lots of places looking for information about what kind of evidence-based interventions will be helpful to us. So what can we contribute? We need to think about what have we learned in terms of strategies for school improvement and supportive learning. We need to think about what we've learned in terms of policy and implementation strategies. Where and how can that learning be applied? Where can partnerships be made with those in districts, in states, in networks who are looking to move forward? We need to keep track of what's working and not working, and why. Because in this new era, we should have a continuous assessment and evaluation process going on to track what's being done and to inform all of the actors about what's working and what needs to be amended and refined to create this virtuous cycle of improvement and learning. In Finland, they call that, which is their major form of improvement. They call that intelligent accountability. It's all about the learning, the evaluation of learning. So we have a real challenge in front of us. It's a moment where public scholarship can make an enormous difference. Many years ago, Horace Mann made the comment that where anything is growing, one former is worth a thousand reformers. I think that's a good challenge to take up. May the force be with you.